man walks up and said, this is a union town, a union town, all down the line. This is a union town, a union town, all down the line. And if you come to strip our rights away, we'll give you hell every time. This is a union town, a union town, all down the line.
History of the NALC through the eyes of the NALC Presidents. The postal system has existed since 1775. The Constitution of 1787 appointed the first Postmaster General as Benjamin Franklin. The Constitution of 1787 also granted Congress specific power to establish post offices and post roads. This authority was defined in 1792 when Congress approved comprehensive postal legislation. In 1794, it officially established the post office as a permanent part of the federal government and authorized the appointment of this country's first letter carriers. After three failed attempts to form a national union in 1870 in Washington, D.C., in 1877 and 1880 in New York City, finally, in August 1889, the Milwaukee letter carriers, knowing many of their fellow carriers would be attending the Grand Army of the Republic encampment in their city that summer, issued an official call to meet during the reunion to form a national association and act on other matters of importance to letter carriers and their families. The agenda was set. 1. The formation of a national organization. 2. Petitioning Congress for an increase of carrier salaries. 3. Organizing a United States Letter Carriers Mutual Insurance Company. 4. The pensioning of carriers after continued service. Number of years to be determined. 5. Providing substitute carriers with a fixed salary during their period of probation. A union is formed. 60 letter carriers gathered when August Dahlman of Milwaukee called the convention to order on Thursday, August 29, 1889, 124 years and 19 days ago. Delegates quickly moved and adopted unanimously a resolution to form a National Association of Letter Carriers. On August 30, 1889, William H. Wood of Detroit was elected as the first president of the NALC. In a room above the Schaefer's Bar, the Post Office Department was shocked to find out the carriers had organized a union. You will see here a picture of the letter carriers of Milwaukee and the letter carriers of the United States. This is a resolution to adopt the National Association of Letter Carriers. And to the right you see a picture of the Schaefer's Bar. This is where our union was created. John J. Goodwin. The spirit of the August 1890 convention in Boston, Massachusetts was one with a catchphrase of, "We should be co-laborers in a common cause." This is where John J. Goodwin was elected with 58 branches and by August 1891, 231 branches. Theodore C. Dennis was the third elected president of the NALC, the union having grown to 333 branches. The Post Office Department, extremely unhappy with the passage of the 1888 eight-hour law for carriers, reinterpreted the law to their liking and were working carriers 8 hours every day. The NALC, although new, hit the ground running and very swiftly and forcefully sued the federal government. The suit surprised everyone and was even more startling was the results of the suit. Frank E. Smith. In 1893, the NALC won the case when the Supreme Court awarded letter carriers a total of $3.5 million, settling thousands of overtime cases. A substantial amount of money during that time. The spotter system was designed during Smith's term. These were men hired by the Post Office Department as a reward for their political loyalty to President Grover Cleveland to travel secretly and spy on carriers. The state associations dated back to 1892. The quiet years. President C.C. Cooden, R.F. Quinn, and John N. Parsons. Outrageous charges by spotters in Akron, Ohio in 1895, a spotter secretly watching a carrier saw the carrier look into a window when passing by and saw a woman and child lying on the floor. The carrier entered the house where there had been a gas leak. The carrier got them out safely. The spotter recommended dismissal for deviation from his route. The union submitted a formal protest over such harassment on October 28, 1895, but the department would not listen. The press finally took up the carrier's cause with articles telling of such harassment. Jeremiah D. Holland, 1902, President Theodore Roosevelt issued a gag order which forbade all postal and federal employees, directly and indirectly, individually or through association, to solicit members of Congress. In 1905, the Ladies Auxiliary formed at the National Convention in Portland, Oregon. William E. Kelly, 27,000 members. The Lloyd Lafollette Act ended gag rule. Postal and federal workers gained right to organize. 1912. Congress passed the Riley 8 and 10 Act, which says that postal employees could not be forced to spread their 8-hour shift over more than 10 consecutive hours. Equally important was a law passed at the same time, the Man Sunday Closing Act, which closed post offices on Sunday, thus guaranteeing postal employees at least one day off every week. Edward J. Gaynor. He had the longest term of 27 years. He led the long struggle to reduce letter carrier hours of work from 48 to 40 hours. His eventual success earned him tribute as the father of the shorter work week. Gaynor also brought his campaign for shorter working hours to all American workers as vice president of the American Federation of Labor, the AFL. NALC affiliated with the American Federation of Labor, the AFL. Women were hired as temporary letter carriers as the men went to war. 1917, dual charters approved. 1920, Civil Service Retirement Act passed. Carriers received sick leave. 1921, PMG William B. Hayes recognized postal organizations. 1930, 58,000 members. Your picture to the left is of James H. Rademacher's dad. He was a member of NALC Branch 1, Redford, Michigan, from 1925. The picture was provided by James H. Rademacher himself. 25 Fairmont, West Virginia carriers submitted mass resignations to protest local postmasters' policies. 1939, NALC celebrates 50 years. Gold cards established for 50-year members. 1935, 40-hour work week for letter carriers. William C. Doherty. He held the third longest term. $300 a year wartime bonus. In 1950, twice-a-day delivery stopped. There were 103,000 members. 1952, NALC headquarters dedicated. 1960, NALC health benefit plan began operation. In 1960, all remaining dual charter branches merged. Doherty has also written a book called Mailman USA. President John F. Kennedy signs Executive Order 10988 on January 17, 1962. Executive Order 10988. The program officially recognized the legitimate role of unions in the formulation and implementation of personnel policies. Kennedy's order provided that a labor organization would gain national exclusive recognition once a majority of the employees in the appropriate bargaining unit chose the organization as its representative. The organization would then represent employees in grievance discussions and negotiate a national contract with the management. Jerome J. Keating. Keating graduated from University of Minnesota in 1930, but remained as a letter carrier because a letter carrier's job offered more security during the Great Depression than that of a college teacher. 1964, NALC Crest. Retirement community for letter carriers dedicated. NALC Crest, NALC, retirement, education, security, and training. James H. Rademacher, 1970. There were 212,000 members and consisted of over 6,600 branches. Settlement of the strike. Equality of jobs. Established a collective bargaining. Postal Reorganization Act. Established cost of living adjustment, COLA, which has added up to over $20,000 to date for carriers. 1975, launched a legislative liaison network and Committee of Letter Carrier Political Education, known as COLSEPT. 1977, Vice Chairman of Postal Committee. Negotiations began. We were stuck on pay raises. On July 18, 1970, the first contract was agreed to. It provided a hefty pay raise, a cost of living clause, as well as a no layoff guarantee. Collective bargaining had replaced collective begging, and the NALC could look forward to a great future. I was very proud of Gus Johnson's courage, as well as the courage of those who followed him on the picket line. Also, I was proud of those other branches which followed Branch 36 out, for if they had not done so, each Branch 36 demonstrator would have faced either prison time and or removal. If I had personally called the walkout under existing law, there would be no NALC today. The most important results of the strike was true collective bargaining. The time to reach top pay was lowered to 8 years rather than 21. The anti-union postmaster general resigned. A 14% pay raise, 8% of which was retroactive to the date of the strike settlement. Even though my meeting with President Nixon was very fruitful, and we had reached total agreement on the legislation, including a closed shop should Congress approve same, Nixon issued a threat of veto over a pending 5% pay legislation. That was all I could take, and the membership was equally frustrated. I issued a letter to all branches on March 3, 1970, asking a vote of agreement that the members would follow me in any action I deemed necessary. Every branch signified by either unanimous or majority. They would even walk out if I asked them to do so. Branch 36 read that letter at their regular meeting on March 12 and readily agreed to support any decision I would make. The demand then was to not wait for my signal, but to go out on March 17, and that they did. Branch 36 President Gus Johnson called me at midnight and told me of the vote and the demand by the majority to go out at once. I merely responded with, "Let it blow, and good luck." The vote was 1,500 for the strike and 1,000 against, with 4,000 not voting. Beyond the profound benefits derived from the strike was the fact not one striker of the 200,000 was penalized in any way except the president of Hartford, Connecticut, Branch 86, who was fined for re-entering the picket line. His fine should have been paid by the NALC. Gus Johnson was fined $200,000 daily until President Nixon asked the judge to dismiss the charges. The strike by letter carriers in 1970 was the greatest walkout in history, providing the beneficiaries with the greatest settlement in history of the trade union movement, and it can be attributed to the courage and conviction of our membership, who risked removal and possible jail sentence or both. From a personal standpoint, I took great pleasure in the Postmaster General being asked to not attend any meetings relative to the strike settlement by President Nixon. I was also elated when this anti-labor appointee resigned when he learned President Nixon would not discipline any striking employee. The previous slides are quotes from James H. Rademacher. Here is a phone call interview. Please enjoy.
The cute things, though you might want to report it, was we were down to the last minute in our first negotiations of collective bargaining. That was in July of 1971. We were down, and it was my birthday, July 18th, and we had got nowhere. And if we did not agree by midnight, we would have to go to mediation. We didn't want to go to mediation. We wanted to settle it ourselves. So everybody was quiet. The hour of midnight was approaching, and a knock came on the door. And I opened the door, and it was a man from the Labor Department. He said, "Here's a birthday gift for you from so-and-so." And so I opened it, and we all sat there watching me open it. And it was one of those little boxes that you squeeze it, and it's a laughing, hysterical thing. And everybody just doubled up laughing. You couldn't help it because of the way it was constructed. And so the representative of management said, "What the hell? Let's settle this. What do you want?" I said, $1,500. He said, "Okay, let's get this over with." So the thing was signed on my birthday because of that little box. So desperate, Nixon was going to veto a pay raise, and we put out an ad in every newspaper in the country, SOS, Save Our Service, write to the president. And he got between 3 and 5 million letters, and they called me, and a man named Charles Colson, who turned out to be a big hero for me, he called me and he said, "We got your message, when can we meet?" I said, "Immediately, I'll be right over." He says, "No, let's make it tomorrow." So he and I then changed the Postal Reorganization Act, at which time the post office was going to be called a corporation. He was willing to change that for me to USPS service. And then we had to also protect our members, because the new bill, in a corporation, they could fire you because you would not be under civil service. So those are some of the things that he accomplished.
J. Joseph Baca. Moving quickly through the ranks, Baca served as station representative and branch president before being elected National Assistant Secretary Treasurer in 1968, Vice President in 1972, and Executive Vice President in 1974. In 1976, Baca ran for president against Vincent R. Sobrato, winning the election, but was defeated by Sobrato in his bid for re-election in 1978. Vincent R. Sobrato, second longest term. 1982, Fair Labor Standards Act litigation settled. Joint NALC-USPS employee involvement process established. 1984, arbitration panel determines terms of a national agreement for the first time. 1989, 316,000 members, celebrates the 100th anniversary of the NALC. 1992, NALC, USPS, and other organizations signed joint statement on violence and behavior in the workplace. 1993, Hatch Act reform, expands political rights for carriers and other postal and federal employees. 1993, Family Medical Leave Act, FMLA. 1999, Arbitrators elevate all carriers to grade 6, breaking historical link with postal clerks. William H. Young, 2003, e-activist. Legislative network created to provide instant legislative updates and rapid communications to legislators. 2005, 301,000 members and 2,500 branches. Negotiated a 5-year contract with the U.S. Postal Service providing for regular wage increases and cost of living adjustments, which the membership ratified by a margin of 9-1, and increased NALC's participation in politics. A leadership academy was also established to train future leaders of the union. Young appeared several times at United States congressional hearings, including those on the overhaul of the U.S. Postal Service in February 2004, the contracting out of letter carrier jobs in April 2007, and the implementation of the Postal Accountability and Enhancement Act in July 2007. Young served on the AFL-CIO Executive Council, as well as on the Executive Committee and Political Committee. He was also the National Vice President of the Muscular Dystrophy Association.
Fred Rolando has had the most serious responsibility of any president in our history, and he's handled himself very well. He has saved the service, and not only has he saved the service, but he saves our jobs.
Turn the storm. Good intentions is gone dry as a bone. We take care of our own. We take care of our own. Wherever this flag's flown, we take care of our own. From Chicago to New Orleans, from the muscle to the bone. Shotgun shack to the Superdome. Rainbow Hill, the Calvary State. There ain't no one here in the beautiful dome. We take care of our own. We take care of our own. Wherever this flag's flown, we take care of our own. With a will to see where the hearts that run over mercy, where's the love that is not forsaking me, where's the work that'll set my hands, my soul free, where's the spirit that'll reign over me, where's the promise from sea to shining sea, where's the promise from sea to shining sea, wherever this flag is flown. Wherever this flag is flown, wherever this flag is flown, we take care of that land. We take care of that land. Wherever this flag is flown, we take care of that land. We take care of that land. We take care of that land. We take care of our own.